in about 27 days, this outer layer of skin that you see will shed and be replaced. Every minute, you lose approximately 30,000 skin cells. Skin cells are flying off our skin as I talk and as you watch. If we lose 30,000 skin cells every minute, why don't we see this much skin lying around us? Oh, it's around you, and it's called dust. You leave small pieces of yourself everywhere, as you drive, as you eat, and as you learn TikTok dances. When you vacuum, you may be picking up food particles or dirt, but the majority of material in your vacuum container are your skin flakes. You're probably grossed out right now, but there's so much more that we need to learn about the skin, which is the largest organ of the body. Since skin is the largest organ, it has some pretty important functions. First, it protects you from pathogens and fluid loss. 2, maintains your temperature. 3, synthesizes and stores nutrients. 4, has receptors that detect pain, temperature, and touch. And 5, has glands that can excrete and secrete substances. Okay, so now you know about the function of skin, let's talk more about its structure. Your skin has two main layers, the epidermis and the dermis. Underneath the dermis, we have the hypodermis. Okay, let's go back up to the top. Here, we have the hair shaft. This is the part of the hair that projects beyond the skin surface. Close to the hair shaft, you should see sweat pores. Sweat pores are openings to sweat glands at the surface of the skin. Let's move on to the epidermis, which is the outer, thinner layer made up of epithelial tissue. Notice that the epidermis in this picture has 4 layers: stratum corneum, stratum granulosum, stratum spinosum, and stratum basal. But if you watched my skin music video, I mentioned that the epidermis has 5 layers. You got that stratum corneum, you got that stratum lucidum, got that stratum granulosum with that spinosum and basal. Okay, what I'm going to tell you is really important, so just hold on 1 second. Oof. Most of your body is covered in thin skin, but in the palms of your hands and soles of your feet, you have thick skin. Thin skin has 4 epidermal layers, and thick skin has 5 epidermal layers. Which layer does thick skin have that thin skin doesn't? If you guessed stratum lucidum, you're right. We will talk about the structure of stratum lucidum in just a moment, but let's get back to the skin. You should see now that we're looking at a diagram of thin skin versus thick skin because this epidermis has 4 layers. Okay, let's talk about each epidermal layer from top to bottom. First is the stratum corneum layer, aka the horny layer. The stratum corneum is the most superficial layer, so it serves as a barrier from pathogens and water loss. It's also made up of stratified squamous cells. If you watched my histology lecture, we learned that squamous cells are flat and thin. If you need a refresher, click the link. If this were a picture of thick skin, the next layer would be stratum lucidum, aka the clear layer. The word lucid actually means clear. The cells in this layer are closely packed and clear. Next, we have stratum granulosum, aka the granular layer. This layer is filled with keratohyalin, which is a dense lipid that helps form the skin's waterproof barrier. Next up, we have the stratum spinosum, aka the spiny layer. This layer has lots of desmosomes. Desmosomes anchor cells to each other. If we applied a stain and looked under the microscope, it's the desmosomes that give the cells a spiny appearance. Last but not least, we have the stratum basal layer, aka the base layer. All of the previous layers that you just learned about are created by the stratum basal layer. In this layer, we find the keratinocytes. These are cells that make keratin and make up more than 90% of the epidermis. These cells undergo mitosis, which is cell division, and they migrate through the other layers until they reach the skin's surface. That takes about 35 days. That's why we say the skin is stratified, squamous, keratinized epithelium. Melanocytes, which are cells that make the pigment melanin, are also found in the stratum basal layer. Each individual in these pictures have the same number of melanocytes. It's the amount of melanin produced by the melanocytes that differs from person to person. The amount of melanin is determined by genetics, which is heredity, and sun exposure. Whew! That was a lot of information, and we only covered the epidermis. Let's move on to the dermis.
Ow! Ow! That hurts. Oh, are you done? Oh, okay. What do you think?
Fortunately, I can wash this tattoo away because it only penetrated the epidermis. In the epidermis, remember that those cells are constantly replacing themselves. The dermis doesn't go through this process of renewal. So, in order for a tattoo to be permanent, it has to penetrate the epidermis and the dermis layer. Another fun fact is that the interaction between the epidermis and the dermis, specifically the papillary layer of the dermis, produces ridges on your fingertips and toes, known as your fingerprints. Your fingerprint ridge pattern, whether it's a whorl, loop, or an arch, is fully developed by the time a fetus is 6 months old. Okay, let's check out the rest of the dermis. The sweat gland, also known as the sudoriferous gland, is a type of exocrine gland. Exo means outside. So when you're working out, the exocrine gland produces sweat that will be released outside of the body through the sweat pore that we learned about earlier. The sweat gland that is pictured here is called a merocrine sweat gland because the sweat is released on the surface of the body. Apocrine sweat glands are sweat glands that are attached directly to the hair follicle. Speaking of working out, if you gain or lose a significant amount of weight, stretch marks, which are small tears in the elastic fibers of the dermis, can occur. Stretch marks can also occur when you as a teenager experience a growth spurt or when a woman is pregnant. Next, we have the hair bulb. Notice that it forms the base of the hair follicle. The hair follicle anchors each individual hair into the skin. The hair bulb also has blood vessels. These blood vessels help nourish the living cells that grow and divide to build the hair shaft. Let's look at the erector pili muscle. Ooh, the hypodermis is so squishy. The erector pili muscle is a small muscle attached to the hair follicle. When it's cold, your body tries to generate heat. So all of your erector pili muscles contract all at once, causing the hair to stand up straight. This is known as goosebumps. Another exocrine gland in the dermis is the sebaceous gland. Notice that this exocrine gland is attached to the hair follicle, whereas the sweat gland secretes sweat directly on the skin's surface. The sebaceous gland secretes an oily substance known as sebum, which lubricates your hair and your skin. If you suffer from acne or sebaceous hyperplasia, that is usually caused by overactive sebaceous glands, which produce excess sebum. Okay. I think we've covered everything that's in the dermis, so let's check out what's underneath my feet, the hypodermis. Notice that the hypodermis is filled with adipose tissue, aka the fat. Make sure you check out my histology lecture if you need a refresher about the structure and function of adipose tissue.
The adipose tissue stores fat and provides insulation for the body. You will also notice that the hypodermis is well vascularized because it contains larger blood vessels and nerves than those found in the dermis. I think we covered all of the structures in the skin.
Man, something cut my arm, but there's no blood. You just learned about the integumentary system. How did I cut my arm, but there's no blood? Did the object cut through my epidermis, but not my dermis? Did the object cut through the epidermis and my dermis? Or did the object cut through the epidermis, dermis, but not the hypodermis? If you guessed A, you are correct. The epidermis contains no blood vessels. It relies solely on the dermis for its nutrients by diffusion. Let's wrap things up by talking about burns.
Several days later.
So, I had a little accident while I was cooking, and now I have first, second, and third degree burns on my arm. It's so convenient that I can use myself as an example for the burns lecture. Let me show you what happened 2 days ago. A burn injury depends on the tissue layers that are involved. Since only the epidermis was damaged, I felt some pain, my finger was slightly red, but there were no blisters. The steam really got me. Unfortunately, this burn is a second degree burn. My epidermis was destroyed and my dermis was damaged. This burn was really painful and I got blisters. I'm sure you already know. Me putting my hand in the oven caused a third degree burn. My epidermis and dermis were destroyed, and my hypodermis was damaged. This may sound strange, but I didn't feel too much pain, but that's because my sensory nerve endings were damaged.
Whew! We covered a lot. We talked about the structure and function of the integumentary system, the five layers of the epidermis, and the three types of burn injuries. I hope this helped, and I'll see you soon. Science G, signing out. Oh, by the way, you may want to go vacuum your skin flakes.